Hi, my name's Joe Culver. I'm from Washington University in St. Louis, and I'll be talking about a wearable high-density diffuse optical tomography system that we've been developing for decoding brain activity. This is a movie of a blushing brain, and when neurons fire, as you know, they stimulate an increase in cerebral blood flow. So where you see red is where the brain is blushing with oxygen-rich blood. And where you see blue, the supply has waned and is becoming more deoxygenated. Traditionally, these blushing brain dynamics have been imaged using fMRI. However, 3T MRI has some logistic issues with regards to being portable and/or wearable. So the motivation for optical neuroimaging is to provide a surrogate for fMRI that can be used where fMRI is precluded or difficult. For instance, perhaps in young kids who would prefer to be seated on their parents' lap while they're imaged rather than stuffed into an MRI board. Some other applications that motivate optical imaging are to see if, for instance, can we detect ischemia during cardiac bypass surgery? Can we predict the outcome of cooling therapy? Could we quantify cognitive function during acute stages of stroke? Maybe longer term therapy, where can we inform therapy of visual function disorders? And another kind of category of applications are implants. So can we monitor their effects of deep brain stimulation in Parkinson's patients, or monitor plasticity in people with cochlear implants? Our lab is focused on dense arrays, where we capture both first nearest neighbor, second nearest neighbor, third nearest neighbor, et cetera. And so the denser sampling enables higher lateral resolution. It's fairly intuitive, more green lines are better. And also there's a slightly more subtle effect, which are that different distances incorporated provide some level of depth profiling. When this instrumentation is put together with anatomical head modeling, which you see on the right, then we can get pretty good mapping. So this is the use of a visual stimulus, which you see on the left, and the subject stares at the center while the stimulus rotates around the field of view. In response, we measure a traveling wave on the back of the head, always opposite to the stimulus. The center movie is diffuse optical tomography, and the right is fMRI on the same subject on a different day. So this is what we mean by developing HD DOT to become a surrogate for fMRI. However, when we expand this technology to reasonably close to whole head coverage, the system expands to something that is not really wearable or portable, on the other hand. On one hand, it's great because we have a very large channel count, everything works relatively smoothly, and we get pretty good image quality for DOT. On the other hand, there are these two 19-inch racks full of optoelectronics and fairly heavy mass of fibers. So the need is obvious. We need to drastically reduce the weight, get rid of the racks of electronics, and get rid of the fibers. To put this on a graph, if you're very generous and neglect the console and only consider the weight of the last meter of fiber, it's around 8 pounds for a portable system and around 21 to 40 pounds for a fixed system. So we want to break this kind of conflict between weight and imaging performance and make a system that's around 2 pounds. Our inspiration for moving into this area is from many others who have been working on fiberless FNIR systems. This is captured well by Rob Cooper in a review in 2017. And since then, there have been a handful of successful high-density sampling systems, as best exemplified by the Cephalogic system and the Gower Lab system. We aim to build a high-density full-head coverage system in this grant. The key performance parameters for the optoelectronics are fairly straightforward and can be illustrated by this graph of light falloff with distance. There are three key numbers derived from our fiber-based system. They are the noise equivalent power, which is basically the noise floor, the dynamic range, and crosstalk between either sources and detectors or detector to detector. I won't run through all the numbers, but we have a laundry list of granular targets. We also have in vivo targets related to mapping the pulse CNR and, of course, retinotopy. We also have kind of more complicated goals with regards to mapping movie stimuli and decoding, which I'll talk about in a few slides. Our implementation timeline is as follows. It's 4 years for four aims, so roughly an aim per year, with the work spread out to overlap between aims. We've completed the first three prototypes of aim one and are just halfway through the working on our fourth and are about halfway through our photometry and movie mapping decoding studies. So in developing the design, we first looked at what we wanted to keep from the fiber system. We wanted to keep benchtop numbers like detectivity, dynamic range, crosstalk, and we also wanted to keep some of the cap fit. The way the fiber tips comb through the hair seemed to be a positive. So roughly the idea was to stuff those 19-inch racks full of electronics into these little small fiber tips or smart optodes. This was fairly straightforward for the LED, but the detector module is more difficult, in part because there are many components. And and the second challenge was just that it's very difficult to keep clean power and ground planes for both the transimpedance amplifier and the photodiode. These modules were then integrated into a 32x32 imaging array, and then this was hooked up to an FPGA and Wi-Fi module and a battery pack. So this system is completely untethered. The wiring is a little bit bulky, but the shrink for that part of the system is earmarked for prototype 4. The key thing about this prototype is that things work pretty well. Detectivity, dynamic range, and crosstalk can all be seen in this light falloff curve, and we largely hit all of our granular milestones. For instance, the detectivity is down around 12 femtowatts per hertz per millimeter squared. We also benchmarked the pulse signal across the second and third nearest neighbor pairs, which we were able to get around 10 dB for most of the optodes. And finally, we looked at retinotopy. And so this, this may not be our best, but it's pretty good considering this was the first data set off the first subject. So we still have more to do in prototype 4, where we'll be focusing on shrinking the FPGA and wiring harness and doing custom cables and building the channels out to 144 sources and 144 detectors. So in aim two, we are working on photometry. We're finding that anatomical co-registration is increasingly important. We started with atlas geometry on one hand and subject-specific MR data on the other. And the goal was to use a 3D scan of a subject to transform this atlas geometry into a subject-specific head model that would match or, do as well as having a subject-specific fMRI or subject-specific MR. After we co-register basically both the atlas anatomy to this 3D subject scan and the MR data to the 3D subject scan and compare the results for fiducial locations. And we can get these positional errors down to about 5 millimeters. So that's our progress on both the instruments and the system algorithms. And our next goal was to develop movie mapping and decoding algorithms. In traditional fMRI or fNIRS, we use tasks to map which brain areas perform the function of a task. This is, in effect, mapping encoding. In this grant, we're interested in reversing that analysis to perform decoding, that is, taking brain dynamics and trying to deduce what tasks were being performed. Decoding may have important clinical applications. For example, augmented communication could be important for patients with Locked-in syndrome, ALS, or cerebral palsy. So for instance, in the movie that this is a frame from, called The Diving Bell and the Butterfly, the subject had a stroke which paralyzed him for all but his blinking of his eyes. But he still had full intelligence and was able to eventually write a book. So augmented communication could help in people like him. We started off with a proof of feasibility using visual retinotopy. Specifically, we took a template matching approach to our decoding problem, where we created templates of the brain response for each of 36 positions. The actual phase is in the first row, where the phase is indicated by both height and color. We then took the data and calculated the correlation coefficients for each of the 36 templates for each time point. We then used a winner-takes-all to make the classifications. The results are in the middle row. As you can see, the performance is pretty good. Another way to visualize the result is to plot the decoded phase on the right, which is in this movie down here, and judge that against the actual phase, which is shown on the left panel of the bottom movie. And you can see that the agreement between those two, the positions of those two sort of clock arms is fairly good. So this is in checkerboards, but we now want to move these techniques back down to children, where it was very unlikely that these strange checkerboard stimuli would work. So we started to look at movies. Movies serve as a rich, engaging, age-appropriate stimuli for children, and we know that from how easily children's eyes get glued to TV screens. But we also verified this objectively in our system using eye tracking data. Here on the left is a representation of a five-year-old participant and where he was looking during a task in which he was asked to maintain central fixation. You can see that his eyes are sometimes where they're supposed to be, but frequently they're darting off the screen and looking around the room. In contrast, when the same participant was asked to watch a movie, his eyes consistently remained on the screen following what was happening there. So to work with the movies, we first piloted this in adults, having them watch The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. Though not kid appropriate, it had lots of close-ups of faces. Here we found that if we made movie regressors of things in the movie, like the sound envelope or speech, we could map out regions of the brain related to auditory processing or imaging, imaging statistics. More interesting were the regressors related to visual categories like hands, faces, which picked up some of the language regions, or bodies, which picked up some of the somatomotor regions. This project is now kind of headed back towards kids using age-appropriate movies. More specifically, we're using Curious George and Moana as source material, chopping them up into short clips and then analyzing the correlation between the two viewings of the same clip. At the voxel level, we can get high correlations if they are the same clip, whereas if the clips are different, the correlation is lower. So this actually cycles back to decoding because it's fairly clear from this kind of matrix of combinations that if the templates are if the template matches the viewing, it's a very high correlation, and if it doesn't match, then it's a low correlation. So in principle, we have the data that we need to decode. However, this is a bit slow as these movies are 5 minutes long. So this project is currently working to look at how well this works with shorter movie clips. So in closing, I'd like to thank all of the lab members, and which is a collective of postdocs, graduate students, and technicians who have been working on this project, along with my key collaborators, Ed Richter, Adam Egebrecht, Mark Anastasio, and Chris Meiser. And finally, I would like to thank funding primarily from the Brain Initiative for this U01 grant that's driving this particular project.